Cheairs family comes here in the very early 1800s. We know that Nathaniel Cheairs III buys some land around 1811, and he built the first house really on the back of what is today the Rippavilla property. Lives there for many, many decades, eventually accumulates hundreds and hundreds of acres. The Cheairs family had a long history before there was the home that we now know as Rippavilla. Nat Cheairs III, who we call Nathaniel, died in 1846. And it was shortly after that his son, Nat IV, who we just call Nat, began formulating plans to build a home further to the west of the first house. The reason that Nat chose the site that is today known as Rippavilla is the Columbia Turnpike had been built several years before his father's death. It really seems that Nat wants to build a rather big, showy house closer to the new road. Well, he began work on this at some point in the early 1850s, and we think it was completed somewhere between 1853 in 1855. Nat was married in 1841, so he and Susan, the former Susan McKissick, had been married for several years prior to his father's death. They had four children. They had two boys, two girls. All four survived to adulthood. By 1860, there were 75 enslaved people who worked, lived at Rippavilla. Nat Cheairs owned over 1,000 acres and was worth today. I mean, he was essentially a multimillionaire. A family like the Cheairs, whose entire wealth status, the foundation of a place like Rippavilla, was firmly built, constructed, and grown on slave labor. They probably thought their way of life was never going to end. Little did they know, within a decade, everything that they knew would come, in many ways, collapsing down around them. As 1860 rolls into 1861, Murray County, where we are, and Williamson County to the north, where Franklin is located, were very different. Murray County was a county that, during the initial push for secession, supported it, whereas Williamson County did not. Nat Cheairs would later recount that he did not support secession, but he, like a lot of other Tennesseans, when it came right down to it, and the state eventually did secede in the spring of 1861, he said he felt compelled to stand with his people, and so he volunteered his services and he became a major in the 3rd Tennessee Infantry. When Nat went off to war, like so many others did, he left behind his wife and children. So Susan, Sally, Jenny, William, and Thomas all remained behind. And Nat's captured early in the war. He was taken prisoner at Fort Donelson, so he's not even in the service for 12 months. And then he was shipped off to a POW camp outside Boston, but he's home by the end of 62. He was paroled, exchanged. And so he is here through the very tail end of 1862, and he's here through most of 1863. And it's a little uncertain right now what caused Nat to re-enter the service, whether he did it voluntarily or whether he felt compelled to do it. But he became an officer in the commissary department. He and the family traveled south, somewhere to a point north of Pulaski, and he left Susan and the kids, and he went off to become an officer whose duty it was essentially to try and round up food. It's at that point, with the Emancipation Proclamation in effect, and even though it didn't apply to Tennessee, this is relevant to the local enslaved community. They're escaping, they're becoming really agents of their own freedom, and we know of at least 4 chair slaves who run away. To be quite plain, with the master gone, these men see their opportunity to be free. Philip and Joshua Cheairs, brothers, escaped, became members of the 12th USCT. One of them actually fought at the Battle of Nashville in December of 1864. Cheairs, Susan and the kids, and eventually Nat, they're watching the complete social collapse unfold, not just around them, but right within the confines of their own lives. And he's captured early in 64, and then he was imprisoned again, and this time for quite a long time. He doesn't get out until the war is over. He spent many, many months, in fact, almost the better part of 15 months, at Camp Chase outside of Columbus, Ohio. An interesting period of time is what's happening at Rippavilla and what's happening to Susan and the kids in 1864. The Cheairs' oldest son, Thomas, it's been said for probably a number of years that Thomas was a Confederate soldier, and he certainly was in the Confederate Army at some point. There was a man by the name of William Briggs who had married into a Unionist family. He's from Western Murray County, and Briggs had made a habit of dressing in Confederate uniforms to kind of get intelligence on what Confederate troops in the area had been up to. He was either ratted out or somebody figured out what Briggs was up to, and he had gotten into a federal column. He probably passed along information to them, and this column of federal troops was moving right through Spring Hill. On the 3rd of July, 1864, when a man from Hickman County rode up and shot Briggs in the head, killed him on the spot. So Briggs was buried by his family at Rose Hill Cemetery in Columbia, but within days, there's all sorts of trouble. Federal authorities, I think, concerned that if a man like Briggs could be murdered or assassinated, federal troops could be in danger, they started rounding up locals. They arrested John Cheairs, they arrested Martin Cheairs, and they came to Rippavilla and they got Thomas Cheairs. We're not exactly certain where they were imprisoned, but likely they were simply detained by federal troops in some area nearby. Nat became aware of this. Nat was actually writing to his sister, who lived in Columbia at the time, about his concerns. Nat was particularly concerned about his son Thomas, but he was also worried about his brothers, and they were detained for several weeks. Eventually, they were released. This is about the time that Thomas joined the Confederate forces. We know that he's not here at the end of 1864 from, again, letters that Nat was writing from Camp Chase, because he specifically, at one point, in a letter to Susan, which was written in December of 64, said to say hello to the children, minus Thomas, but he said, say hello to Thomas if you see him. I think it's possible, based on the time frame and kind of what's happening through this area, that Thomas, we know he was attached to Nathan Bedford Forrest's cavalry at the very end of the war, because he did surrender with Forrest in Alabama in May of 1865. He has one card in his service record, and that's it, that he surrendered with Forrest. Forrest had led a raid into this area in September and early October of 1864. It is possible that Thomas joined then, or felt that he had to get out of the area, and thus joined Forrest Cavalry. If that's true, if he was with Forrest at that stage, he likely was with Forrest in November of 1864, which means he may have come right through this area on the day of the Battle of Spring Hill. And the last thing about Thomas, we know he was part of Forrest's escort because he's actually listed on an escort roster by George Cowan, who was John and Carrie McGavick's son-in-law. Cowan listed T.G. Cheairs on the roster. It's a really incredible story, but nonetheless, the war ends, Thomas comes home, Nat's released from prison, and then he comes back to Rippavilla on June 2nd, 1865, and at that point found the farm itself commandeered by the Freedmen's Bureau, and Susan and the kids, he said, were living on government rations. And so he had to sign a loyalty oath, which he did a few weeks after coming home, and then he had to apply for amnesty, which he did. By the end of 1865, he has the farm back. Life was obviously very, very different. Lots of similarities to other families. A, they have to figure out how they're going to survive, because now 4 million people have been freed. Life was very different. So one of the things that unfolds here that's a little different than, for example, even at Carnton, where John McGavick is entering into labor contracts with black laborers, over the years there begins to develop this area known as Cheairs Quarters. They were paid laborers, some former slaves perhaps from Rippavilla, but certainly former slaves from the area, who actually worked here. And one of the foremen who begins to become pretty well known in the area was himself a former slave named Sam Bond. It's just an interesting, unique component of Rippavilla. But as far as Nat and the family, they continued to live here until the early 1890s. Susan died in 1893. Nat really seems to, I think, have lost interest in having Rippavilla be his permanent home. He sold it about a year later to his son, William. And then he traveled around a lot. He lived in Western Murray County in 1900, was back here at some point with William in 1910. But in his later years, he spent a lot of time with Jenny. She lived out in Waco, Texas. And that's where Nat died in January of 1914. His son-in-law, J.M. Moore, who was a Vanderbilt graduate, had married his daughter, Sally, went out to Texas, got Nat's body, brought him home, and today he and Susan and the kids are all buried at Rose Hill Cemetery in Columbia, Tennessee. So it's an incredible family story. It's an interesting family story. It's a complex family story. And I think through the years here at Rippavilla, we'll certainly continue to learn more about them. But they were people of their time, living in a difficult and ever-changing world. And Rippavilla is really just another piece of this very deep fabric of American history.